You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And if hopefully, fingers crossed, this has happened, there's now no more black in this room. It's all blue in this YouTube thing because I still don't like editing, but Zoom apparently lets me do that now. But nobody cares. Let's all talk about my guests at this time. I am joined by two guests that have been on the show before a long time ago. First off, he was on episode 10. Of the SWN podcast when I was bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, and had no notes. It is Ross Hunter. Welcome to the show. Welcome back.
Thank you, Billy. Yes, you're right. It was episode 10 you had me on. That was an awful time. I will not lie to you. You asked me what my favourite dinosaur was, and I nearly cried.
Well, that question has been retired. You'll be glad to know.
Keep it that way.
Also, the two sheep, one cow's questions being retired as well, so you won't have to fight about that. My other guest at this time, he was back in episode 120. That was back in December 2021. For those that are curious, today's episode should be episode 275. So I am joined also by Robert Balfour. Welcome to the show.
Gentlemen, how are we doing?
Very well. So for those that are unaware, you would have seen the title of the episode, so you should know already. That means I'm joined by the par, and as I put in the Zoom invite, we're in the par clubhouse. Let's have some fun.
How immature.
That was terrible, Billy.
You know, it doesn't get much better than this, I'm going to be honest with you. So, buckle up, guys.
It better be worth my time.
So, hopefully it is. I've got a question. So, The last time I was on this podcast, as Ross says, I was asked what my favourite dinosaur is. So, Billy, what's your favourite driver?
Oh, well, it's been a while since I watched Formula One. So
No. What's your favourite driver?
I don't know. I played golf once and spent most of my time making sure nobody looked at me as I threw the ball. I don't understand it. But I'm not judging people that do. So
shallow.
It's an expensive sport. You know,
and we are expensive men.
Yes,
exactly. And I'm paying for your time right now. Hopefully, in clicks and views, and I'm sure there's going to be thousands of them when we put this episode out.
Why wouldn't there be?
Exactly. So what we're going to speak about is about the par, about the journey of the par so far. It rhymes. Didn't mean that to. And we're also going to talk about Power Pro Wrestling's Rise of Power event, which is taking place on June 13th. At Truth Nightclub in Leven. So we'll bring that up during the episode as well. But in general, guys, last time we spoke, you were a tag team. Or in the case of maybe for Robert, you were on the cusp of being a tag team. So
you were the Woke Academy.
You were the Woke
Academy. Don't even say that name, Robert. We don't need to talk about that anymore.
So let's not mention the name, but talk about the tag team itself. So how did Redacted come to be? So how did you guys hit it off and become a tag team?
Very, very easily. We're two professionals, two athletes, and we're refined. Simple as that, Billy. We started off at wrestling roughly the same time. We came to Power Pro. We decided, you know what? We're both elite athletes and no one is better than us. So what did we decide to do? Combine the two, and yet there was born a tag team. Yeah, we started off as the Woke Academy. Let's never, ever go back to that. Because all the Woke Academy brought us was loss after loss after loss after loss. And now, let's just think about this for a second. As the par, we've never lost. And we decided, let's go our roots. We both play golf. So we thought, let's go our roots, right? and we became the part, and now look at us now. On June the 13th at Rise of Power, we're in the Tag Team Championship Tournament.
Which we're going to win, by the way.
Yeah.
Fairly comfortably.
But I suppose, but I mean, when you're talking about loss after loss, I'm looking at your opponents, your first five opponents anyway. According to the interweb, it is cage match. So I'm assuming there will be matches missing, but we'll go with what we've
got. It'll be roughly correct, yes.
Roughly correct. Yeah. So your first matches was against Charles Weiss and Ian Skinner. Ian Skinner, of course, is having an amazing career down south right now.
I'll agree with that.
You lost. And you're against Synergy, who's, again, an amazing tag team to face off against. The 99, Greedy Souls, Glasgow Grindhouse. So it's not like you were in the ring with jobbers, so to speak.
My point still stands, Billy. It was loss after loss after loss after loss. Those were elite tag teams. Elite
not
tag
anymore.
Teams.
Not anymore. Not anymore. Continue.
I will do so. So, but even then, you were in ICW tag team title matches at FPWA when it was FPWA, now Power Pro. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, even though you were
and we lost.
We lost.
Let's not labor on the negative. Let's look at the positive. So you got those matches, though. So clearly, you had the potential. People were seeing you guys as the team that they feel you are now. People were seeing that to give you those opportunities, to put you in with those teams earn those opportunities to be in with those teams and be in those matches. So did you find, even though you weren't really being true to yourself as that team, but did you find that as that chemistry, though, that was undeniable? That was just there. You just needed to kind of grow into who you were.
The chemistry was 100% there. There was just small pieces that let us down, and I feel a big piece of that was pandering to the audience. Clapping, giving high fives, caring about getting cheered. If we didn't get a reaction, yeah, we were gutted. See, if I didn't get a reaction now, I couldn't give a shit.
Yeah. That's the thing. Like, we're not going to go out of our way to excite these fans now. We're not going to go out of our way to do these big springy, flippy moves just to get that little, oh, wow, from the crowd. Because quite frankly, nowadays, all we care about is getting that W. Because to be honest with you, I couldn't give a flying fuck what those people think about us anymore.
Well, one person...
They can hate us, they can love us. I don't care.
Well, one person did come in with a comment, not a question, so I'll leave the questions for a little bit. Was Len Ironside, who was very complimentary. He just said simply, one of Scotland's best tag teams. Has Len been someone that you've been able to pick the brain of at all? He seems to be quite... He's very active on keeping an eye on the young talent in Scotland, certainly. So is he a guy that you've been able to touch base with?
So, I've known Len since I was 17. I'm 23 now. He's always supported me. He's always been there for me to speak to. He's always given me advice. Good advice, by the way. Better advice than a lot of people are qualified to give. So in terms of Len, I have complete and utter respect for him. And whatever he says should be listened to.
I agree completely with Robbie. Like, when I started off, I was about 13 years old. I'm now 20. And Len was there throughout that time. And every time I got the chance to speak to him, I learned something new. So yeah, nothing but respect for Len, I have to say.
Sorry, I don't want to interrupt. What do you got?
I was just saying, he gets, Len's the king, man. Like, he gets wrestling.
He does. I've been lucky enough to speak to Len in person at shows. And he's just so in tune with what's going on. And even you think, as a veteran, possibly he could possibly just rest his laurels, but he always seems to be finding, like yourselves, finding these new fresh faces and trying to maybe give them a little bit of a nugget here or there to move forward. So yeah, big fan of Len here on the podcast, certainly. But yeah, so So we're not going to concentrate on the losses, but we want to concentrate on the opportunities that you've earned. So some of the mentioned some of the teams that you've been up against. Is it a case of when you're against like of a Greedy Souls, like of a Synergy, that even though that L was there, so put that to the side, you're always finding an extra thing to add to your arsenal. You're able to find a little bit of a little bit of information to evolve yourself into the par in those matches.
Okay. Yeah, that's actually a good question, but well done. So let's take the Greedy Souls, for example. So the first time we wrestled the Greedy Souls was on ICW, and myself and Robbie didn't last 5 minutes, right? We were absolutely destroyed by those two. And you know what? I would have done the same thing if I were them. We were two fresh-faced young boys who didn't have a clue, and we thought we could walk in there and beat them, and we were so mistaken. But here's the thing. Fast forward about a year or so, and we wrestle them then FPWA versus New Wave. And yeah, we came up short.
Let me just jump in. The only reason we lost there is because the ropes were oiled up and I slipped. That's the exact reason we lost that match.
You did, I remember that. I remember that because it was actually quite a scary moment. Robbie slipped and nearly concussed himself on his head against the floor. So if you ask me, main reason we lost is that. Because if you go back and you watch that match, you see that me and Robbie gave absolutely everything we had, and we were this close. We were this close to beating them. And I'm telling you, if he hadn't slipped for those ropes because of whoever put that damn ring up, we would have won that match. I'm telling you that right now.
Just to interject as well, that was a big turning point. People who were at that show will know the Greedy Souls said something to us after that match. They said something about us in the promo. We need to get our act together or we're going to get put to sleep. They said something to us after that match. Me and Ross will keep that between ourselves, but the Greedy Souls are a big inspiration now for what you see, and that is the part.
You're certainly right. So after that match with the Greedy Souls, this is when I started seeing the par appearing on show after show, and seeing you guys on show posters, match graphics, and the likes. And again, big teams that you're coming up against. Just wanted to go a little bit further forward from that match with Greedy Souls when it was FPWA versus New Wave, the return leg down in Wales, down in Cardiff. So that's when you were against Bolarama. And I think possibly, I don't know if you would say the same, this is when things were starting to go on the up properly.
I'd agree.
For the par. I guess Bolarama, again, a very well-established tag team in the UK, a team that I've seen Splits McFins probably more times on my social media than I care to admit. That's a big travel.
Same, by the way. Same.
A travel to go down to Cardiff, a win, get the dub there. What was that? What was that kind of journey down about? Was it all strategic? Was it a bit more relaxing? Was it like, because it's a big travel down for a bit of the wrestling.
Ross slept the entire way down, which makes our win down there even more impressive, because we must have uttered 10 words to each other in the space of 8 hours, because he slept like a baby the whole journey. Anything to add to that?
I like to sleep. I'd slap the head off them 7 days a week and twice on Sundays yet again.
That's actually more impressive than anything else. Like I said, barely a chat, and you went and picked up the win. I'm near a guy that can sleep in a car. I like, especially when I'm driving. It's not a good thing to do.
Well, I'd hope you don't sleep when you're driving. That would be rather concerning.
It would be. It definitely would be. Safety first, people. My attempts at humor are not to be messed with the par on this evening. It's a serious job. It's serious wrestling. Which it is, because you guys, after that match, that's when, I mean, of course, there were still L's in your future for a moment, but again...
Thanks for reminding us, Billy.
But, again, putting the positive spin on things, it's still the caliber of opponents that you're going up against, the places that you're wrestling, so people are still knowing about the par finding out that they're still a formidable team, because they wouldn't have you on their shows. The promoters wouldn't demand to have the Power if they didn't see that the Power were the future, present, and everything in between as a tag team. So next match I'm going to bring up, just and then we'll scatter about a little bit, will be your debuts at Discovery Wrestling. Again, positives. Look at the positives here. Against Fair City Saints, who by the time...
But can you tell me what the name on the bill was for that match? I believe it was the Woke Academy.
It was the Woke Academy. For that event.
Clearly, straight into our head, we went back in time.
And
shit happens. We've not. I don't actually think we've lost since, maybe once. That was a year ago. So
yes, but anyway, but the debut Discovery Wrestling. So yeah, was that a graphic designer issue? Was that a graphic designer that maybe was trying to sabotage you guys against First Eight Saints?
If I speak, I'm in big trouble.
Yeah. I don't know. But nonetheless, that match at Discovery Wrestling, our debut in Livingston, to be honest with you, Billy, if we're talking real talk here, I enjoyed that match because the majority of the time we were beating the absolute piss out of the Fair City Saints. And then they got the jump on us. But that was once again, we were in our own heads. We had to stop that. We were in our own heads. We were the Woke Academy. I don't know why. We were the Woke Academy.
So, I mean, as of now, when this episode goes out, it's a year later and the Fair City Saints are no more. Air Miles will have retired the weekend as we're recording. So Alex Webb is now on his lonesome. So, I mean, you could say that could your beating, even though it wasn't the outcome you wanted, that beating caused the demise of the Fair City Saints, one of the highly regarded teams in Scotland. So we could take that.
We got that far in their head. He retired less than a year later.
And that's it. That's all she wrote.
That doesn't make you scared to face the Power. I don't know what does.
We're looking into the future. Well, looking into a little bit more closer to home then, more recently. The Power is properly born. You're no longer this name, this dead name has been put into pasture. The Power is 100%. Before I get into the wrestling side of things, I've already admitted I'm not a golfer. I know very little about golf outside of maybe watching Happy Gilmore. So tell me a bit about the guys, your bond as it is on the course, how you guys got into the sport itself and then bringing it together.
Were you talking about wrestling or golf?
Golf.
Let's go for golf. About golf.
I played golf since I was about 4. Was natural at it. My family plays, pretty much everyone in my family plays. As soon as I picked up a club, I was probably better than most amateur men. And now, if I shoot more than one under, I'm pretty unhappy with myself. So, yeah, I'm a natural. Like I am at wrestling, I'm a natural at golf.
And yourself, Ross?
Couldn't have said it better myself. For me, it was my step-granddad. He got me into golf when I was about 8 or 9. And since then, I've went with him every time I go to Glasgow to go and visit him. I'll go to the golf club with him. We'll play a couple of rounds and then sort it. And so, as I say, natural.
As a layman, when it comes to this sort of thing, I don't know how it kind of works with style and what have you. Because I know for football, you'd be able to maybe emulate or see something in footballers or anything like that. When it comes to golf, though, is that same works? Do you watch other professionals and maybe pick up a tip here or there?
I video myself and I watch myself. That is the only person worth watching other than Ross Hunter.
Beat me to it by a second. I was just about to say the exact same thing.
Well, let's leave the golf chat behind because I'm swimming into a sea that I know very little about. So we'll leave that for the moment. Thank you very much. Let's look at more recent times with Power Pro, more specifically. You've added a little bit of a extra Nope, going to be a cough pun. Don't know any. He added Mr. Manival to the unit, to the tandem. What was it about Mr. Manival that did he approach you? Did you approach him? How did this relationship begin?
We were approached with a business opportunity from Mr. Manival. Could have went better. Didn't go quite as planned. We may work with Mr. Manival in the future. We may not. But at this current moment in time, Ross Hunter and Robert Balfour are the only two members in the par, the only two members managing the par, and the only two members that the par need. So all respect to Mr. Manival, but we thought we needed him, but we didn't.
And that's brought us with the meat factory. That seems to be where you're headed.
Wait, hold on a minute. What did you just say there? Say that tag team name again.
Meat factory.
Say one more time.
Meat factory.
Oh, the big lads. Heads off them twice.
The big lads. Yeah.
Oh, well, that's kind of where I was going to go, because you guys.
Slap the heads off them twice.
You guys have got the jump on them a couple times now.
Not got the jump. We beat them twice. Well, no, actually, scratch that. We beat them to an absolute pulp once, and then after that, we pinned them and beat them the second time.
What is it about the meat factory that is particularly got you after them?
Well, let me just explain this, right? They've got it in their thick little piggy skulls that for some reason they are the premier tag team in Power Pro. Billy, I beg to differ. Have you seen the part? Have you seen the way that we perform? They haven't got nothing on us. So we did everything that we've done for that exact reason. And before you come on to the fact of, oh, but you're just jealous. We're not jealous. We're proving ourselves once again that we've had to do time after time after time after time. And we're sick of doing it. So instead of proving it in a match, we'd rather just beat the absolute piss out of them.
I wasn't going to question any further. But yeah, if for yourself, Robert, is it just the same?
If I'm being honest, I don't have a problem with them. I don't care enough about them to have a problem with them.
It's business.
They're just an obstacle. The reason that we went full par, you could say, in September, is because they stole our spotlight. Simple as that. They shouldn't have been in that position. The only time since they've been in that position was against us. And what happened? They lost. And I'm sure nothing's confirmed yet. I'm sure they'll be in the Power Pro Tag Team Championship tournament. And I'm sure they'll exit early on because they're losers.
So we'll go back to the online questions, and then we'll properly dive into June 13th and talk about possibilities and people that you may want to face, not only as to better yourselves, whether you think you need to be bettered or not, and or just opportunities you want to have. But back to the questions here, we've got Patrick Tiersky. He's asked thoughts on Liv. He's put golf, not Morgan.
I believe the players who are accepting contracts from LIV are smart. They're setting their family up for the future, and playing golf in Saudi Arabia is no different to WWE superstars going to Saudi Arabia to make money. Fair play to them. You turn down that much money, you're an idiot.
Right. So is this like the... Just again, because I'm...
Liv is a golf organisation that is backed by Saudi Arabia.
All right. So I was thinking it was like the when the football teams tried to do Super League or...
an alternative to the PGA.
Right. All right. I'm learning. I like to learn on these podcasts. Usually it's anime. I'm happy to learn about other things, and golf, I will listen. But yeah, so for yourself, Ross, are you guys in sync with that opinion? Have you got anything to add to that?
Nothing to add, Billy.
Fair, we'll just move on then. We do a question through Twitter, X, whatever you want to call it, from Anwar Mouse. I don't know how this question is going to go, and we may just move on after I ask it. They've asked, who has the more female fans and who has the more male fans?
We have the same fans. We're the same team.
Yeah.
That's strange question, Mr. What's his name?
Anwar Mouse.
Says a lot.
That was a stupid question. We're a team with the same amount of fans.
That's fine. Yeah, we'll move on. So a question is actually a bit more appropriate. We've got Westy here. She's asked, power aside, the tag team division in Scottish wrestling is on fire. Is there a particular tag team you have your sights set on who you'd like to face next?
That is a very good question.
Whoever is put in front of us next is who I want to face next.
Yeah, if everyone wants to step up.
A team that I do actually like is the young team, to be fair. They're entertaining. Similar sort of styles and ages to us. So if you're asking for a team that I like, probably them. I'd like to face Casino Brutale again. Just to beat them again, because why not? What other tag teams is there, apart from the PAR?
I want to throw out a tag team, and I think you'll be very interested in it when I say it. Currently at Fair City Wrestling, where you guys have competed as the old name. The tag team champions at the moment are Zach Dynamite and Ryan Riley as the foundation of the future. Now, I'm putting them forward because I see a lot of similarities between the PAR and that iteration of the foundation of the future. Ever since I've seen Ross wrestle, I'm like, Zach Dynamite all over it. And for yourself, Robert, I can see that cerebralness that Ryan Riley also offers. So I think that's a complementary team for the PAR.
I don't think I've got the cerebralness of Ryan Riley, though. I'd compare myself more towards Triple H, if you're gonna use that name.
Yeah, I'm not believe. Did you just say I'm like Zack Dynamite?
I'm seeing similarities to yourself as Zack Dynamite.
Similarities.
Yeah.
So, I'm not inferior to Zack Dynamite, or am I? Tell me the truth.
Of course you're not. Of course.
No. I'm seeing that that you guys have some similar traits. Whether you're inferior or superior, that is not something I'm implying. I'm just saying there's some traits involved.
Well, I think the only way to decide who's inferior and who's superior to the other is they could step up to the part.
I will say I like their attitude. They have the right attitude.
Yeah.
They don't pander to the crowds, much like
Chris. Put it this way, they're champions for a reason. I'll give them that.
And I mean, if I put out there Fair City Wrestling or Power Pro, whoever wants to bring this match to life, there's titles to be had as well. If the Fair City titles are Fair City tag team titles are put on the line, so I'm not putting that out there. It's just as me to tick a box for my Northeast fandom. It's actual. Got to get some gold in there if we're gonna have this match, and
maybe we should get some gold in there. If we wait until June 14th, we can maybe put our belts up as well. Because, let's be honest, we're the inaugural champions. We've not won it yet, but
may as well.
I'm out of time.
So, speaking of that, then yeah, we're going to do a big, big, heavy chat about Power Pro Rise of Power, which is taking place on Tuesday. No, it's taking place on Thursday. Thursday, 13th of June at Truth Nightclub in Leven. Doors open 6 p.m. Finish approximately 9 p.m. Tickets probably won't be available by the time this comes out, because these shows sell out very quickly for Power
they
Pro.
Do.
New era of Power Pro Wrestling. Last show found a new heavyweight champion in Frank Gallo. He'll be taking on Sam Gradwell. And like I said, this tag team tournament, from what I can gather from this poster, this lovely poster that they've put out, we yourselves are definitely involved, as you've already announced. And the Meat Factory will be involved, who you've already stated that, well, you've beaten them, so that's fine. who is there any tag teams that you would want in that tournament just for a case of you could say be all end all, that's who you've beaten them, you've become the new Power Pro Tag Team Champions?
I would like to face whoever is considered the best tag teams in Britain, Europe, the world, just so we can simply say we've beaten the best to become the best.
And I know that's exactly what management is going to do, because they're not just throwing together a tag title tournament and going, here you go, let's just crown some champions for the sake of it. They're doing it because they believe in the tag division. They know that the tag division is where it's at. And that's why they're not just going to chuck team after team in there. They're going to put the best of the best in there. That's why the Power's in there.
I mean, that's why we've seen what Power Pro could do with that kind of thing. I mean, they brought Niwa up for the heavyweight title tournament. They've developed all these relationships with the likes of New Wave, with the likes of Iron Girders as well. So it's one of those places where I've heard nothing but good things about Power Pro, and I know that the guys have been kind enough to have kind of got an outstanding invite to go. And it's one of those, well, eventually I will get there because I have to see what this is all about at Truth Night Club, because the crowds are absolutely electric. Even though you don't care about their opinion, the atmosphere when you go to Truth Night Club must be undeniable, though. Must be an incredible experience.
Well, if you go on the 13th June, you'll know yourself, Billy. So I want to see you there.
The Woke Academy would thrive upon the atmosphere on June 13th, but we don't particularly care for it.
No.
As long as it's sold out, as long as we get the winner's paycheck, as long as we get paid for showing up, happy days.
So we'll talk about experiences for a moment then. So you guys, with talking about those things of Power Pro working with other places, of course the news came out that they are now affiliated with Mega Slam, so that means you guys get to wrestle all over the country, not just Scotland but England and wherever Mega Slam are, which is everywhere it seems. As far as learning and those kind of things, it's a bit of a different experience with Mega Slam. The crowds, you see the pictures of the crowd. Again, I know you don't care about the crowd in general, but is there any moment where you have a little bit of a moment where you look out and see how big the crowd is and you're in a place you've never been before? Do you feel the nerves at all when you have that kind of moment?
Okay, well, if I could just jump in here and I will answer this one for you. So earlier this year in January, I went to Mansfield and I wrestled Martin Kirby for the Mega Slam Championship. And in that crowd, there was about 450 people there. And that was one of the very few times where I can say I was very, very nervous to go out in that match. I was extremely nervous. Probably the biggest match of my career to date. But coming out of that match, although I got the loss, and that is a loss that I am more than man enough to say that I took, because I took it to Martin Kirby. Honestly, probably one of the best Britons ever produced. And I took the fight to him, and yeah, I came up short, but would it have been cool to win? Of course it would be cool to win. But he's the champion for a reason. And he was by far the better man that night. But after that, it was just a feeling of, I feel like I did something here tonight. You know, it was one of those feelings. And I came out of that, and to this day, it's probably the best singles match I've ever had. My favourite that I've ever had, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I'm the same. Obviously, it's massive crowds. You're getting to travel around the country. I've been lucky enough to travel over to Ireland and wrestle for them as well, so you know, it's a fantastic experience. Good experience working a different style.
Yeah,
I love it. It's great. The only time you'll hear me say that.
That's the one thing I would say, that doing the Mega Slam style was one of the funnest styles I've ever done. It's great fun.
I suppose in that respect, it's you guys are so heavily focused on the par and that chemistry. When you get thrown into these singles matches, I'm not saying that you're ill prepared, but what's the word? You're just your body's prepared to be able to tag out and all that kind of stuff. So maybe when you go, especially going in with someone like Martin Kirby, who's been the tag team champion, who is, I think, tag team champion at Target at the moment. So he's got many years under his belt with both kind of facets of that thing. And if you guys are so heavily focused, just to use it as an example, just to plug my own shit here, but I was speaking to Ace Austin yesterday, Clang. Speaking to Ace Austin, he was speaking about his match with Mustafa Ali and saying that he, even though he put everything into it, because his body of work right now is so concentrated on ABC with Chris Bay, that's the reason why he couldn't put maybe 110% into that match, because his body's so used to the tag team wrestling. Do you find that possibly that could have been a factor in that match with Martin Kirby, certainly in just singles matches in general at the moment, because the par is your main focus?
I would say there's some truth to that there, Billy, yeah. For me, I do think there gets to a point when you're in a match and it gets to a point where you're like, oh, you know, now's the time where I need to tag out, but you're in that zone. You've been going by yourself this entire match, and then you find that within you to keep going, but it doesn't always go your way. And I think a main reason for that, for me, is because I don't have my tag team partner there. I've had some success in singles wrestling. As you said it, when I wrestled Dead and Blair at FCW, came out on top.
Clean victory that was, by the way.
Clean victory, completely.
I mean, Deirdre Blair's a fantastic wrestler as well. There's some amazing young talent in Scotland coming up the ranks, and you guys are just going to batter him on the way down, I suppose. That's kind of the be-all end all of that. So we do have a bunch more questions through the Instagram. I'm just going to go and find them. So, you know, I'm not just looking at my phone for no reason. There's definitely a reason for it. They're from Zachary Swift, who's sent some more lighthearted
questions. A gentleman, blast.
He sent some lighthearted questions, which was very kind of him to do so. A guest that we've had on very recently as well. We'll go with the more heavier of the two first, and then we'll end with some of the fun stuff. So he's asked, who do you think will be the next Power Pro champion? So Frank Gallo, Sam Gradwell, that's coming up. Who do you think will be the next Power Pro champion?
What? How do you mean next champion? Dad, are you asking me who's going to win between Gradwell and Gallo? Or are you asking me who's going to be the next champion in general of Power Pro?
I think we'll see the next champion in general. I think that's what Zachary Swift has alluded to.
I think the next champion will be the next person that pins Frank Gallo.
Edging your bets, like it. I like that answer. It's a good answer.
If I had to put money on somebody, I'm going to throw a wild card out and say Talon Jr.
See, you know what, Rob? I got to disagree with you there. For me, I got to say it's got to be my boy Tommy Cartel.
Two strong choices. Tommy Cartel, of course, at this moment in time, he's challenged Andy Roberts. And he's the former hardest man in Fife as well. So he's got the credentials. And Talon Jr., I hear some wild things about him and his family. I can't totally trust that man. I think, or we don't know if he's a man, really. He's a Talon Jr. So he could do it as well. That's two strong picks to be the next Power Pro heavyweight champion. Fantastic. These other questions. So a bit more lighthearted for the episode. In the Power Pro locker room, who is, let's give us a list, so we'll start as we go down, who is the funniest?
The funniest?
Me.
Yeah, it's Robbie. Better landslide.
The most caring?
Daisy Jenkins.
Is that agreement?
Me.
And most annoying?
Me.
Fair most annoying, probably Tommy Cartel.
Yeah, it's me or Tommy Cartel.
Fair, absolutely fair enough. So as we kind of wind our way back in this episode, so we're talking about Rise of Power quite a lot. Recently, you've been able to well, Power Pro have had seminars with some fantastic NXT UK wrestlers and just wrestlers from around the world. When it comes to especially like the tag teams coming through, was it Subculture that were through recently? Am I remembering that right?
No. It was
the GY.
Matt Gibson and James
that
Drake.
That was it. Apologies to the Grizzled Young Veterans for mixing them up. How would that even be possible? So yeah, Grizzled Young Veterans coming through to Power Pro. A team that I think maybe is a team that, not that you model yourself after, but certainly draw some inspiration from for their style and for what they do. I was like getting to pick the brain of Zach Gibson and James Drake of Grizzled Young Veterans.
Well, unfortunately, Robbie was on sabbatical at that point, so he couldn't attend last minute, which is quite a shame. But me, I went, and it was probably one of the best seminars I've ever been to. So much informative stuff. I know they love the tech wrestling, and I personally am not a big tech wrestler, but after that seminar, I've taken a liking to it a little bit more, and a lot of tag stuff that I was asking them, a bit of strategy, which I'm not going to share with any of you because I don't know who's listening, but a lot of tags team strategy there that they gave me the shout about. So yeah, I think a lot of stuff that we do can be from the GYV, if that makes sense. You know, like a lot of the stuff we say, I think can be taken from little bits of the GYV into the PAR.
Ross, sorry to interrupt. Billy, this is going to be a solo interview for 2 minutes because I'm going to piss myself.
Fair enough. I think that's the first time someone's announced it on the podcast, but on you go.
He does that up a lot.
Okay, so yeah, we're back with Ross Hunter then. We'll keep going because, you know, we'll bring Robbie in when he comes back.
Yeah. He's lost his voice anyway. Who cares?
So yeah, so we're talking about, because when we last spoke, I couldn't believe it when you said that you're 20 now. You're 16-ish when we spoke last.
Oh, yeah, I was 16 when we first spoke, and I'm 20 now, so.
Which has maybe broken my brain a little bit, because when I started this podcast, I was, oh my god, 29, something like that, 29. So it's a long time ago. So in that interim period between you to us having that chat and name redacted, how did you feel like you'd, how was it? I'm just making it as vague as possible there, but how was your journey between that time?
So when we first spoke, Billy, I was just, to put it very bluntly, I was just a little boy. I was a little boy who had just broken into the wrestling business, and I was trying to get my name out there. And I thought a way to do that was to jump on your podcast, which I feel like maybe did me some bits of good, but not as much as I would like to, because I wasn't the same man I am now. Because fast forward 4 years, and that 4 years has been long, hard. I've been getting my ass kicked for 4 years. And I've been having great matches. I've been having terrible matches. I've been up and down the country. I've been doing everything I possibly can do to get my name out there. And with Robbie with me, I feel like we're at this stage now where we're just going to be stepping on everybody else to get to the top, to get to where we want to be.
The fact that in your innocence, last time we spoke 4 years ago, I teach you how to change your name on Twitter. That's the innocence that you had back then. And nowadays, you guys are just...
Yeah. Do you know what happened, Billy? I grew a fucking set of balls, Billy.
Yep. And certainly, you guys, I'm seeing the promos, I'm seeing the videos, and you guys are just, you're not taking any shit from anybody. And that's very evident.
Why should we?
Exactly. Usually I would do things like dream matches, but again, I know the answers, which is everyone and anyone, because you're going to beat them. So it seems a moot point for me to do so. But with likes of Grizzled Young Vets, I mentioned subculture erroneously, but I mentioned them as well. When you see teams like that, is that just makes you add fuel to the fire to get to the point where you have earned a match with those guys, with teams that are like that, like your FTRs, like all those kind of teams above? Is getting to spend some time with them, getting to watch what they do, is that the fuel that drives you forward?
It's good to challenge yourself. The names you've just listed up, subculture especially, I'd love to wrestle. Just to challenge myself, just to challenge Ross. I believe it's something that would thrive upon. So any team that are higher established than us could bring it.
Excellent.
I completely agree with him there. I mean, as the saying goes, pressure creates diamonds, and when we're under pressure, we thrive at our best. I mean, so far we've been undefeated, and we're going to keep continuing that way through June the 13th when we win the tag team championships and onwards throughout the rest of time.
Let's just get one thing clear as well. There's a showcase on June the 12th. We'll be there scouting. We'll be there watching people who could be in the tournament, people who could possibly be up against us in the future. We don't take that lightly. We do our homework on individuals, on teams, on everybody. We don't sleep on people.
Well, I kind of did when we went to Wales. But like,
that's true.
Dream of championship glory, which may just happen on 13th of June at Truth Nightclub in Leven. This has been an absolute wonderful chat, and I'm sure that we're only scratching the surface of the power that we'll get to in the near future. To finish off this episode, we're going to go right back to the start of the episode with the question that you asked me, because again, people will know. I won't. People will know when they listen. What's your favorite driver?
My favorite driver is the tailor-made burner.
I have to agree with Robbie there on that one.
Excellent. So unanimous for the tailor-made driver.
By unanimous decision.
Yes.
So to close out then, where can people find out more about the PAR if they do wish to do so? Social media, whatever you want to plug. Merch, and I noticed that you've got merch out now. So where can people find out more?
That's correct. So I am at Robert Balfour PAR on Instagram. I am Robbie Balfour on Twitter or X. And if you're interested in merch, drop me or Ross Hunter a DM. Our store will be live after June 13th. It's pre-order only until then, which will be available for collection at Truth.
Yep. And for myself, I'm Ross Hunter PW on everything, X, Instagram, Facebook. June the 13th, the PAR merch comes out. Pre-order yours now. DM either one of us to get yours in.
Excellent. Well, wonderful. Thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. I'm glad that we got to do this little catch-up again from the episodes from three or four years ago.
3 years ago, 4 years ago.
Yeah, three for Robert and four for Ross. And I can't believe I'm not going to wait that long again to get you back on if your time allows it, of course.
It's been a good interview, William, so we will accept your next invite.
Thank you very much.
You know what, Billy? You've fixed yourself from the last time. The last time I was very upset because I was so young and you had just started your podcast and I wasn't too impressed with you. But this time, Billy, you've fair improved. So
you've been a bit more professional.
Yeah.
Not athletic, not refined, but you've been professional.
If you ask me what my favourite dinosaur is, I swear to God this is the last time we'll ever speak.
No, that is well retired now. I'm now a professional. I ask professional questions on this podcast. It was formed from season 7. So all the silly questions, unless they're asked by the fans, they're all gone away with. But yes, we'll close out this episode with that. And like I said, we'll speak to you again. But yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you,
Billy.